Minecraft Redstone is a vast and often confusing part of the game. Most Minecraft players often avoid it entirely because it can be difficult to learn and oftentimes unintuitive.
Would you say it's hard to learn Redstone?
Yes.
But let's see if we can change that. Hello everyone, my name's MD and welcome to Practical Redstone, a series in which I plan to teach you the way Redstone works to the point where you can design your own farms and contraptions. You can apply these skills practically in your worlds, hence the name. Long-running viewers of the channel will know this isn't the first time I've done this. Practical Redstone was a series I attempted near the start of my channel, but I wasn't happy with the way I did it. So like fellow Redstoner and YouTuber MattPatWings, I will be redoing the series as Practical Redstone Reloaded. Before we start, let me clarify a few things. This series will be starting on 1.21. As updates and mods release, the series will continue on the latest updates. Please note, a lot of things covered here will not apply to Bedrock Edition. The Redstone systems function very differently and it's impossible to cover both. Lastly, I'll be using a resource pack called Redstone Tweaks by Rexstone to make it easier to understand the Redstone. You can find both the mods and resource packs I use linked in the description, and I recommend you get the packs yourself as they make learning much easier. Without further ado, let's start off with the simplest component. The redstone block. All it does is one thing. It activates any adjacent redstone components. Think of redstone power as electricity. Certain blocks, when activated by redstone power, will perform certain actions specific to the block. Similar to how a bulb would turn on if you switch the power on. For example, when I place a redstone block here, the fence gate and door both open, and this redstone lamp turns on. Redstone lamps are good indicators for redstone power since when activated they turn on and emit light. As you can see from this example, the redstone block will only activate immediately adjacent blocks and nothing beyond that. It also does not work diagonally, only to its six sides. In that demonstration, you may have noticed that the redstone lamp turns on instantly, but there's a very small delay before it turns off. This fraction of a second is measured in something called game ticks. What is a game tick, you may ask? Well, Minecraft has an internal clock that it runs on, in which every cycle all the game events are processed. This could be anything from the day passing to mobs moving. This clock normally cycles 20 times a second, making each cycle 50 milliseconds. Each one of these 20 cycles is called a tick. In each tick, there's a long list of events to process before moving on to the next tick. This system provides a reliable and consistent cycle that can be used to measure things like the time it takes for a redstone circuit to run. If the game is lagging, however, a tick may take longer to process than the usual 50 milliseconds, but we'll cover lag some other time. Back to the redstone lamp, we say that the lamp turns off after 4 game ticks. Since one game tick is 50 milliseconds or 0.05 seconds, 4 game ticks is 0.2 seconds worth of delay. In 1.20.4, Mojang implemented a very useful command called /tick, which was previously part of Carpet Mod. Using this command, you can slow down or speed up the game using /tick rate, followed by a value. Note that the default is 20, which we discussed before. You can even use tick freeze and unfreeze to pause the game's clock, and tick step to process a fixed amount of ticks before stopping, which is useful for testing and debugging redstone. Let's now look at redstone dust, which is essentially the connecting wire of the game. Dust needs a flat top surface to support it, and can go up and down blocks. Dust by itself doesn't do anything. When you use a power source like a redstone block, however, dust has the ability to transmit that power along its lines. But as you can see, that range is not infinite. Redstone dust has a power value, which is also called signal strength, that decreases by 1 every block it travels. Right next to a power source, that value is 15. As you move away, it decays all the way down to 0. At any point where the power is not 0, redstone dust can power and activate other redstone components, and it does so fairly intuitively. Dust always powers the block it's placed on if it's conductive, and will also power blocks that it visually points into. What do I mean by conductive? Most blocks in the game can be powered in the sense that if a power source runs into them, adjacent components will activate, just like if that block became a redstone block. For example, if I place stone between this dust and lamp, the dust points into the stone and powers it, activating the adjacent lamp since stone is conductive. If I take a block like glass and put it instead, you notice that the lamp stays off. We can conclude that glass is not conductive from this. Fun fact, another interesting test for conductivity is placing the block above a chest. If you can open the chest, that block is not conductive. Don't ask me why, it's just one of the many quirks of the game. Commonly used non-conductive blocks for redstone purposes are glass and slab variants, since they can support the blocks above them. Coming back to the dust line, you can see that if the supporting block is glass, the blocks adjacent do not get activated, the same if you run dust into them. While with a conductive block like concrete that gets powered, adjacent components activate just fine. However, there's one component that won't activate next to a block powered by dust. Can you guess which one it is? It's dust. Shocking, I know. Other sources of power can power dust through a block, as you will see later, but dust itself cannot. You may hear some people use the terms hard and soft powering to explain this mechanic of dust, but from my experience, these terms are more confusing and unnecessary than they have to be. There's no difference in the type of power in the code, nor is there any other component that gives so-called soft power, so it's better to have dust as an exception. Moving along, if dust is not connected to any adjacent dust, it can take one of two forms, a cross or a dot, which can be interchanged by right-clicking it. All this does is change whether or not the dust powers any adjacent blocks, which as you can see is reflected by how it points into the blocks or not. There is also some interesting behavior with how dust connects up and down blocks. Normally dust will just run up the side of the block and connect with the one above. However, if you place a conductive block on top of the ascending dust, it cuts it off, which doesn't happen if the block is non-conductive. This isn't the interesting part. That comes when you have dust placed on non-conductive blocks. Power travels just fine going up the block, but if you try it the other way, it just stops. Dust power does not travel down a conductive block. This can be used to do one-way signals. There's one more important thing. Since a conductive block doesn't cut the redstone line, you can make a tower of blocks and dust, and the power will transfer upwards just fine in a very small space. These are usually called glass towers or slab towers, and are very popular methods of upward signal transmission. That's enough about dust for now, so let's look at another one of the first redstone components to be added, a classic redstone torch. Redstone torches can be placed on the top or sides of blocks, and by default, they are a source of redstone power and a weak source of light. They activate any component adjacent to the torch, and they power the block above them. Torches are quite useful for powering blocks from below, a rare property in redstone. There's one block they cannot power, however, and that is the block they are attached to. The specialty of redstone torches is their behavior when the block they are attached to gets powered. When this happens, after a short delay of 2 game ticks, the redstone torch simply turns off. When a torch is off, it no longer emits light or redstone power. The redstone torch thus acts as a simple way to invert a redstone signal. If the input powers the support block, the output from the torch is off, and vice versa. Since the torch has a delay, you can actually make a simple and fast clock with it by simply running its own power into the block it's on. The easiest way is this setup. But wait, why does it just stop? This is a mechanic called burnout, where if a redstone torch changes state more than 8 times in 60 game ticks, the torch will turn off regardless if it's being powered or not. The only way to turn the torch back on is to let it rest for 60 game ticks, and then provide it with an update. Now let's look at some of the ways for players to interact with redstone, the inputs if you would. There are 3 main types, levers, buttons, and pressure plates, and all are quite simple, so let's blitz through them. Levers can be placed on most flat surfaces on any side, and they have an on and off state that you can change by right-clicking it. When a lever is on, it activates any components adjacent to it, and it powers the block it's placed on, which if conductive can activate adjacent blocks as you know. Buttons are similar to levers in the way they power blocks and how they can be placed, but unlike levers, they can only provide power for a short time when right-clicked. There are 2 main types of buttons, stone and wooden, and both can provide power for different durations. Stone buttons power for 20 game ticks or 1 second. Wooden buttons, on the other hand, power for 30 game ticks or 1.5 seconds. Wooden buttons also have a special feature where they can be activated by projectiles. Stone buttons cannot do so. Finally, we come to pressure plates, which can only be placed on the tops of blocks, and when stood on, they power like a button or lever would, activating the adjacent blocks and powering the block below. Like buttons, pressure plates have stone and wooden variants, but they also have 2 additional plate types, the weighted pressure plates. They have similarities, so let's go in order. Stone pressure plates will activate if there is a mob or player whose hitbox intersects with that of the plate going up to a quarter block above it. Once pressed, the plate will check every 20 game ticks if there's still a mob or player in that area. If there is, it will stay down, and if not, it pops up and stops powering. That 20 game tick check is why the plate doesn't pop up immediately after you get off. Depending on when you get on and off, it can be the next tick or 19 ticks later. Wooden pressure plates are exactly the same, except for one key difference. They activate with any entity, not just mobs and players. The weighted pressure plates are like wooden plates in terms of activation, but their power check happens every 10 game ticks instead. The reason they are called weighted plates is because they output a different signal strength depending on the number of entities on them. This is in contrast to other pressure plates that always output a power level of 15. The gold light-weighted plates increase by 1 power level with each additional entity on it. You can see this as I spam arrows on it. It goes all the way from 0 to 15, and of course it doesn't go beyond, because that's the limit. The iron heavy-weighted plates are less sensitive, as you can expect from the name. Instead of one entity increasing the power by 1, it takes 10 entities to increase the power level. Repeating the same arrow spam, you can see it takes a lot longer and a lot more arrows to increase in power. The main use of these plates is in counting the amount of mobs in a space. Well, that's enough theory for today. Let's put what you learned into practice with a few exercises. Using only the components covered so far, those being redstone dust, blocks, lamps, and torches, as well as the inputs, here are some things you can try. These will help you get used to the concepts of connections and powering we discussed. First off is alternating lights. The idea is simple. Just have a line of redstone lamps where every alternate lamp is on, with a control lever that when flicked switches the state of all the lamps. Next is a flow ring, a small circle of redstone lamps with a single input that turns them all on at the same time. One more lamp arrangement you can try is doing letters. Try lowercase ones like this for a bit more of a challenge. Let's also work with a bit of logic. Using the basic on and off states of redstone, you can do binary logic. If you want to go in depth with this, you can check out Matt's LRR series like I said before. But for now, consider AND and OR operations. Using these, you can make systems that work based on input combinations. Try your hand at something like a different input combination or a lever combination lock. If you need help with these exercises, or if you'd like to share your attempts, then head on over to the NoobTech Discord, grab the Practical Redstone tag, and share your work with everyone there. With that, we come to the end of the video. I hope you enjoyed it and found it useful. Kindly drop a like and share the video to help support me. Don't forget to subscribe if you want to see future episodes, and I'll see you in the next one. Thanks for watching.